Hello and welcome to the session on Techniques for Higher Learning Seminar and Symposium. Most of the teaching techniques have been developed for secondary level schools. In colleges and universities, higher learning should be encouraged, and to do so, lectures will not be sufficient. We cannot always follow the method of memorizing and classroom teaching. An education institution can achieve its goal of education only when it encourages its students to think, to approach matters critically, and to be proactive. And in order to achieve this, learning should be taken into a higher level. To promote higher learning in colleges and universities, there are certain learning techniques. In this unit, we will discuss the following techniques used to promote higher learning in education institutions of higher education. And both teachers and students can benefit a lot from these higher learning techniques. Important higher learning techniques are seminar, symposium, workshop, etc. These techniques will encourage students to think logically and critically, formulate ideas and present them with clarity to their fellow students. These techniques will encourage students to think logically and critically, formulate ideas and present them with clarity to their fellow students. By becoming a part of the higher learning techniques, students will learn to express their view and difference of opinion without hurting others. Now, let us discuss each of these higher learning techniques in detail. Let us begin with seminar. A seminar is defined as an instructional technique of higher learning, which involves paper presentation on a chosen theme. The paper presentation will be followed by guided group discussion to clarify doubts and to generate ideas to further develop the paper presented in the seminar. Seminars provide a platform for a group of students to have guided interaction among themselves. The persons who present the papers are supposed to study the topic or theme of the seminar thoroughly and prepare the paper well in advance. The paper will be circulated among the members prior to the presentation. Objectives of seminar. A well-organized seminar aims to achieve the following objectives. Cognitive objectives. A seminar aims to create a platform that allows participants to achieve certain cognitive objectives. It encourages students to analyze, synthesize, and evaluate the situations presented before them. The human interactions take place at a seminar requires a student to evaluate and organize the facts she or he comprehend quickly and then present them logically. The seminar aims to develop a participant's observation skills also. The human interactions also help student seek clarity and defend his or her points effectively. Next, affective objectives. A seminar as a higher learning technique aims at developing a student's emotional side as well. The affective objectives are as follows. The human interactions among the group help develop a tolerant attitude towards opposing views. It helps participants to respect different views and will inject in them a sense of cooperation. The participants can learn good manners of asking questions or acquire etiquettes of social interactions. Roles in seminars. In order to make sure that the objectives of seminar as a higher learning technique is obtained, the activity should be well coordinated. To ensure proper coordination, certain responsibilities are allocated to various people. The following are a few key roles required to conduct a seminar. First of all, organizer. It is the responsibility of an organizer to plan and organize the entire program. The organizer can decide the topic or theme of the seminar and assigns various aspects of the theme to different speakers. The date, venue, and time of the seminar are determined by the organizer. Convener. Organizer has the right to suggest a convener, and it is the convener who conducts the activities of the seminar. He or she encourages the participants to take part in constructive discussions and keep the discussion on the theme. At the end of the seminar, the convener can summarize the discussions and present her or his views on the subject. The convener also offers vote of thanks. Speakers. As mentioned earlier, the organizer assigns topics to the speakers and then they prepare a detailed and well-researched paper on the topic. The papers will be distributed to the participants well in advance. The speakers should be able to answer the questions put forward by the participants in a healthy and constructive manner. They should be able to handle criticism in a healthy manner. The next role is of participants. Typically, there could be 25 to 40 participants in a seminar. The participants should engage with the papers and views presented by the speakers. They should be able to look at the views presented in a critical way and should be able to formulate and articulate questions and doubts. The participants should be tolerant and should appreciate the views of the speaker. Observers. Observers and guests are also allowed to participate in a seminar. As the name suggests, they observe and put forward their views and opinions in question answer sessions followed by the paper presentation. Advantages and types of seminars. Advantages of using seminar as a technique of higher learning. As a learning technique, a seminar can help develop several abilities of students. It has many advantages when it comes to the overall development of a student. A few of the advantages are stated below. As a result of participating in intellectual and thought-provoking discussions, stimulated thinking takes place. This will lead to the development of higher cognitive abilities such as analytical and critical thinking, synthesis, and evaluation of ideas and facts. Participants may develop tolerant attitude towards different views and perspectives, and tolerance is an essential quality a human being should have. Participants will learn to respect norms and develop democratic values. This is achieved through the question and answer sessions after the presentation. In order to participate in a discussion, a student must respect norms of the seminar and niceties of a group discussion. Seminar as a technique of instruction helps students develop better learning methods. While preparing paper or participating in discussions, students develop an aptitude for independent study. They take self-initiatives to learn more. As an instructional tool, a seminar has great value. It makes learning learner-centered and tries to impart knowledge by encouraging inquiry based on natural inquisitiveness of a human being. Prerequisites of a seminar. The seminar as higher learning technique demands maturity from the participants. The maturity is expected in terms of use of language, social behavior, and the ability to comprehend abstractions. Since students of lower level classes do not have these qualities, seminar cannot be used in such classes. An abstract theme that needs to be presented and discussed is an integral part of any seminar. Constructive interactions between the speakers and the participants are an absolute necessity for the success of seminar as an instructional medium. A seminar also requires certain procedure. They are: prepare and present a paper based on the theme of the seminar, followed by the presentation. There should be scope for discussions where the participants can seek for clarification. Participants should be allowed to make observations using their knowledge on the theme and raise issues related to the theme for further analysis, evaluation, and development of the theme. Proceedings of the seminar are normally guided by a chairperson who is well versed in the theme. She or he keeps the discussion focused, encourages maximum participation, and consolidate the view expressed at proper stages. As a learning technique, one of the objectives of the seminar is to encourage interaction, so there should be enough time for discussions and interactions. Types of seminars. Based on the level of organization, seminars can be classified into the following types. First of all, mini seminars. Mini seminars are conducted in the classroom. Typically, they are organized before a main seminar. The purpose of organizing a mini seminar is to train students on the organizational part of a seminar. This will help students to learn to perform the various roles and duties required to organize a seminar. Another type of seminar is main seminars. These types of seminars are organized in departmental or organizational level. They will have the theme, and all the students and faculties from the department participate in the seminar. They can be organized weekly or monthly. National seminars. As the name indicates, they are organized in a national level. Eminent scholars on the theme are invited as participants. These types of seminars are conducted by an association, and the secretary of the seminar will be residing on the place, date and time. Another type is international seminars. These types of seminars are conducted by international agencies such as UNESCO on themes that are internationally relevant. A country or a university can also organize national or international seminars. What are the limitations of a seminar? Like every other medium of teaching, seminars also have their limitations. A few of them are as follows. A seminar cannot be organized on all the aspects of a subject. Only a theme that offers scope for discussion can be selected for seminars. Seminars are not ideal for lower level classes as it requires social maturity from the participants. Sometimes in seminars, a habitual speaker dominates the discussion, which reduces the focus of discussion to one person. During the session, an anti and for group for certain ideas can be formed, and this can make interactions unhealthy. There could be situations where criticism can be made for the sake of criticism, which can hamper the spirit and purpose of seminars. Next, we are moving to symposium. Symposium as a technique for higher learning. Symposium are yet another instructional technique that is used to obtain higher cognitive and affective objectives. The Greek philosopher Plato has used the term to denote good dialogue. Another meaning of the word is the intellectual recreating of enjoyment. In recent times, the meaning of the term has been reverted to a meeting of people to discuss a theme or a problem. Now, we are moving to objectives of a symposium. The main objectives of the symposium are as follows. To understand different aspects of a problem or theme, to develop the ability to make judgments and decisions to find solutions for the problem, to develop values and responsibilities of social interactions, and to enable the listener or participants form policies to resolve issues in a theme. There will be two or more speakers who will present their view for 10 to 20 minutes to develop approaches or solutions for a given problem. The speeches are followed by questions or comments from the audience. What are the limitations of symposium? Symposium as a higher learning technique has a number of limitations. They are: the speakers have full control over the paper they are presenting. They can choose to present any aspect of the theme. The chairperson does not have any control over the speakers. Since speakers can choose what they should present on a given theme, the chances of repetition cannot be ruled out. If different aspects on a theme are presented randomly, listeners might not be able to fully comprehend the issue. If used properly, symposiums are a great way to enhance the cognitive capacities of a student. It can also motivate them to conduct independent and self-initiated study. When a student gets an opportunity to express his or her views, she or he may get motivated to explore more and find out more about the subject. Seminars and symposiums can also be used as a tool to encourage the use of library for extra reading. Now, we are moving to workshops. Workshop as a technique for higher learning. The term workshop is typically used in the field of engineering, and in the field of higher education, workshops can be used as a technique for learning. We all know that education is both a practical and theoretical process, and instructional techniques are used to develop both practical and theoretical aspects of education. We have seen that seminars are organized to develop cognitive, emotional and social skills of a student. Workshop, on the other hand, works as a great tool for achieving the psychomotor aspects of an individual's development. The development can be achieved through training. In a workshop, participants just don't sit and discuss. They are given training and use certain tools. For instance, participants can be trained to use new educational tools. The participants have to indulge in certain practical works to learn how to use new teaching and evaluation tools. For instance, teachers can learn how to make use of smart classroom technique to improve education through a workshop. There will be demonstrations of how to use this new platform and how to make students interact and respond to this innovative learning tool. What are the scope of a workshop? The workshop technique is normally applied in the following areas of education. They are, for a new format of lesson planning, preparing objective type tests, creating action research programs, for micro teaching, for designing program for teacher education, to prepare research proposals and synopsis, and for creating internal assessment techniques. In order to conduct a workshop, we need the following portfolios. They are an organizer, a convener, experts or resource persons, and participants or trainees. Now, let us go through the different objectives of a workshop. As we mentioned earlier, the main objective of workshops is to develop psychomotor skills of students. The following are a few psychomotor objectives of workshops. To attain proficiency in planning and organizing instructional activities, to enable a student to perform a given task independently, to determine and use teaching activities effectively and judiciously, and to train a teacher for different approaches of teaching. Workshops, in fact, allow a person to conduct extensive study of a situation, including its background and socio-philosophical implications. Teachers can also benefit a lot from workshops. This method can be followed to provide in-service teachers training. Through this technique of higher learning, teachers can comprehend the new trends and techniques used in the field of education. Workshops also encourage high degree of individual participation, as each and every participant gets individual training. How we can organize a workshop? These are the points to remember. Normally, workshops are conducted for 3 to 10 days. The duration can change depending on the nature of the workshop. There are 3 stages of conducting a workshop. In the first stage, a paper presentation based on the theme by experts followed by discussions. First stage of a workshop can continue for 2 or 3 days. Second stage. The first stage is used to provide theoretical and background knowledge to the participants. But in the second stage, participants have to individually work on the task, for example, writing exercises or lesson plans, etc. Participants will be divided into groups, and each group will have a supervisor to guide and supervise the task. All participants have to complete the task in a given period and discuss their work with their group members and prepare a report. In the third stage, all the group meet at one place and present the report. Participants can offer comments to improve the task done by other groups. Expert speakers can also help to provide their suggestions and feedback. Follow-up phase is an integral part of any workshop. In case of teachers, they are asked to continue their work by applying it in their respective classrooms. The teachers have to assess the feasibility of the learning technique. The participants are invited for a follow-up program to share their experiences and analysis in the meeting. Advantages and limitations of a workshop. What are the advantages? Workshop as a technique of higher education has many advantages. A few of them are listed below. Workshops can be used to understand the proficiency of a particular teaching technique. Workshops can be used to enhance professional proficiency through in-service training. It offers opportunities to develop the individual capacities of a teacher. Workshops promotes cooperation and group work and can be used as a platform to introduce new teaching and learning methods. What are the limitations of workshops? A workshop has the following limitations. Workshops cannot be organized for larger number of people. The effectiveness of a workshop lies in the follow-up program. Most of the time, a follow-up program is not organized after a workshop, and success of the workshop lies in participants. If the participants are less enthusiastic about learning, a workshop will fail to achieve its objectives. There are other techniques for higher learning, such as conferences and panel discussions. In the next unit, we will discuss them in detail. Let us summarize what we have discussed so far. In this unit, we have analyzed techniques of higher learning, which include seminar, symposium, and workshop. We have analyzed the different aspects of each one of these techniques and have learned that each of them have cognitive and affective objectives. The main objective of workshops, unlike the other two techniques, is to develop psychomotor skills of a person. All these teaching techniques achieve those objectives by encouraging active participation of the teachers or participants. These learning techniques not only urge the participants to develop self-learning, but also enhance a participant's social and emotional skills. The discussions and interactions take place during these activities teach a participant the value of tolerance to different views and perspectives, cooperation, and the importance of respecting the other individuals. Workshops help a participant to understand the spirit of group work while allowing her or him to develop individual talents and skills. We have also analyzed the limitations of each of these learning techniques in this unit. Now, you can try to answer the questions given here. What are the cognitive objectives of a seminar? What are the advantages of a seminar? What are the types of seminars and describe each one of them briefly? What are the objectives of a symposium? What are the advantages of a workshop? Now, you can refer the books given here. Mastery of Teaching Skills, written by Chowdhury SBJR and published by Discovery Publishing House, New Delhi in the year 2004. Advanced Education Technology, written by Sharma RN and Chandra S and published by Atlantic Publishers and Distributors, New Delhi in the year 2003. Thank you for watching this program. We can meet again with another topic. Have a nice day.